So it finally has happened. Quick, everyone to the happening bunker! SpaceX's Starship SN5 really did the static fire test. And now, of course, the whole world is waiting for the 150-meter hopping test. But when, sir, when? So let's analyze all the details of the static fire and the upcoming hopping test.
But there's of course much more happening. We will talk about the FCC permit for the 20-kilometer hop test, about the Demo 2 Dragon return to Earth, about the Crew 1 mission. We will even talk about the Starlink launch and copycat Bezos' own Starlink network. We will also talk about the Perseverance rover launch, even about the Virgin Galactic spaceship interior. Hell, even about NASA's pandemic relief bill and what it will mean for Artemis. An insane amount of news this week. So let's get started.
We can't believe that it finally happened. This is basically the happening. So last week on Thursday, we could witness the first successful static fire test of SN5 with the latest Raptor engine SN27. After many delays, we could see this flawless static fire test take place for a duration of about 7 seconds. 7 seconds of pure, magnificent beauty, if you ask us. The test was a full success. No unforeseen leaks, no unforeseen flames, no nothing. Just pure, flawless static fire. And now, of course, after this success, Elon has announced that the hopping test will follow very soon. Yesterday, on Sunday, was the primary road closure date, but there are secondary road closures today and tomorrow, so on the 3rd and 4th of August, respectively. And since we did not witness any giant cylinders flying around at Boca Chica yesterday, this means that the hopping test will happen either today, so probably sometime after release of this video here, or tomorrow. We will, of course, be watching.
Meanwhile, other cool stuff is happening at SpaceX. For example, SpaceX has quietly applied for an FCC permit for 20-kilometer high hop tests. If granted, the permit would allow SpaceX to conduct the 20-kilometer high hop tests and the famous subsequent skydiving maneuver in the time frame from August 18th to February 18th, 2021. So this is quite interesting. Because now we know within which time frame we can expect the 20-kilometer hop test and skydiving maneuver. And Orbital Wedge already shows us in this awesome animation how that skydiving maneuver could look like. Meanwhile, Bob Behnken and Doug Hurley returned from the ISS and landed safely back on Earth with Crew Dragon, marking the successful completion of the Demo 2 mission. After 64 days aboard the ISS, they have really deserved the cheerful applause and honors, because their mission marked the beginning of an era of sustainable and economical spaceflight based on reusable rockets and spacecraft. And thanks to Jim Bridenstine, NASA is to allow reused flights of both Crew Dragon and Falcon 9 for future flights, further driving down costs and increasing sustainability, which Jim Bridenstine said are NASA's main goals now. Congratulations to Jim Bridenstine. He did this so excellently. He played this game of chess perfectly. And now SpaceX is the main company on which NASA is relying on for human spaceflight. Not Boeing, not Lockheed, not Northrop, but SpaceX.
And the next mission to the ISS with Crew Dragon and the Falcon 9 will be the Crew 1 mission. Scheduled to launch in spring 2021, for which NASA has now announced the four crew members. They will be NASA astronauts Shane Kimbrough and Megan McArthur, serving as spacecraft commander and pilot, respectively. Akihiko Hoshide from JAXA and Thomas Prescott from ESA will join as mission specialists. An awesome crew, and we wish them the best of luck for this Crew Dragon mission to the ISS. And if you think, hey, those two funny looking people talk about some quite interesting spaceflight stuff, and what? Even about disruptive technologies like Hyperloop and electric air taxis? Then why not subscribe to stay up to date about the forefront of technological progress?
And another Starlink launch. Another batch of this time 57 Starlink satellites have now been carried into orbit by a Falcon 9 rocket launched yesterday from Launch Pad 39A at Kennedy Space Center. The number of total functional orbiting Starlink satellites now stands at almost 600. It's what we would have liked to happen, and would happen in a parallel universe. In our universe, however, the next Starlink launch has been delayed to August 6th. And now SpaceX has received the FCC approval to test Starlink ground stations in 6 states, namely in California, Minnesota, Idaho, Alabama, Georgia, and Montana. Each of SpaceX's Gateway Earth stations features 8 antennas, which are manufactured in-house by SpaceX. The antennas come with minor and major diameters of 1.5 meters each, and located 3.2 meters above ground level, having an input power of 50 watts, an effective isotropic radiated power of 66.5 decibel watts, being an indicator of the antenna's maximum power output in a single direction. This will pave the way for the upcoming internal beta test of the Starlink user antennas, scheduled for September or October, and the public beta test scheduled for the end of this year. Public launch will be in early 2021, but initially only for the US and Canada. The rest of the world will follow later on.
And of course, there is one who, let's say, doesn't really like these developments, namely Jeff Copycat Bezos. This guy basically has made it his life's holy mission to copy Elon Musk wherever he can. Reusable rockets? Check, gonna copy that. Electric cars? Check, gonna copy that. Self-driving technology? Check, gonna copy that. What could I copy next from Elon? Oh yeah, the Starlink thingy seems pretty nice. Could generate a lot of cash. Yeah, I think I'll copy that next. So he did just do that, and Amazon has now received FCC approval for their Kuiper constellation. The FCC said that Amazon has until July 30th, 2026 to launch at least 50% of its satellites in order to maintain its authorization, and until July 30th, 2029 to orbit the full constellation. Let's hope that 2029 won't look like this here.
Let's see if Blue Origin will have their new Glenn rocket soon, because 50% of the planned 3,200 satellites by 2026 means that they should not be too complacent. And we are pretty sure SpaceX won't help Bezos launch his Kuiper satellites. As things are going now, Starlink might already have all its satellites in orbit by 2026 and generate gigantic amounts of revenue, which will enable us to build cities on the Moon and Mars. But okay, we have to say, at least Bezos is trying to copy Elon. That in itself is already smarter than the other billionaires, who just spend their money on giant penthouses and yachts. So we should at least give Jeff Bezos a bit of credit for just copying Elon.
Then in other news, Perseverance has launched on the 30th of July aboard a ULA Atlas V rocket, and even though there were some technical glitches, the rover is okay and is set to arrive as planned at Mars on February 18th, 2021. Now the rover entered safe mode because of unexpected temperature fluctuations, but this isn't dangerous for the rover. It will be put back into operational mode ASAP. Once on Mars, the rover will begin its mission in Jezero crater, which is thought to have been an ancient riverbed, as can be seen in this false-color NASA image. It will search not only for signs of past Martian life, but can indirectly also search for present Martian life by detecting organic molecules in the soil. This is all nice and fine, but we've said it many times that what we would actually really need would be a successor to Viking's labeled release experiment to once and for all detect Mars microbes with 100% certainty. But as things are looking, this probably will be a mission for the first astronauts to arrive on Mars at Erebus Montes with Starship at some point in the next 10 years. The exact date, of course, being highly dependent on how things will develop with Starship.
Then Virgin Galactic showed off the fancy interior of their SpaceShipTwo. The SpaceShipTwo will enable passengers to experience weightlessness for about 6 minutes on suborbital flight. For only $250,000 per seat. The whole trip duration will be 2.5 hours, so not exactly cheap. But hey, at least space tourism is really starting. And as always, the more a new technology matures and gets adopted, the more the prices will come down.
In other news, a pandemic spending package introduced this week in the Senate would provide $1.5 billion in supplemental funding for NASA. Although the exact amount of money the agency needs to cover its cost remains to be determined. The bill, introduced on July 27th by Republican Senator Richard Shelby of Alabama, chairman of the Senate Appropriations Committee, what a lovely title, provides $306 billion in supplemental funding overall and is part of a broader Phase 4 relief package estimated to cost at least $1 trillion. Shelby's bill, formerly known as the Coronavirus Response Additional Supplemental Appropriations Act 2020, is intended to cover costs incurred by various government agencies in response to the pandemic. Now, Jim Bridenstine was very happy with that, asking for support of the bill by members of both parties in the Senate and House.
Normally, we are not fans of Richard Shelby, who is a diehard advocate of the SLS. And of course, we know why. Because many parts of the SLS are built in Huntsville, Alabama. But here, we have to praise him. But of course, this bill still has to pass the Senate. And let's hope it can pass the Senate. And that the Senate won't pull a Palpatine on us.
I am the Senate.
As well as the current NASA fiscal year 2021 budget, both to be decided in October. We hope the bill will pass, because NASA needs as much money for the Artemis moon program as possible. If this bill passes together with NASA's fiscal year 2021 budget request of $25.2 billion, then we are getting more optimistic again for the 2024 Artemis moon landing.
And if you want to know how Starship could help us to build giant moon bases, you can watch this video here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report. And I'd say, on to the future.
Yes?
Yes. You wanna say it?
Why not?